I'm Jace. I am the U.S. Program Officer at the Fulbright Commission based in Brussels, and we're the ones that run the Fulbright Schuman Program, which I'll be talking to you all about today. Joining me today is Kyla Castro from the Institute for International Education back in the U.S. She's the Program Officer that helps our commission run the Fulbright Schuman Program, and she's here to help answer any questions that you might have about the application process, which IIE runs back in the U.S. before applications are sent our way. So thank you once again, Kyler, and yeah, I'll get to it. So first, I wanted to start off with a short little overview of our commission. So our Fulbright Commission is based in Brussels, and we do two main things. The first one is administer the Fulbright program in both Belgium and Luxembourg for the bilateral programs that we have, but then also administer the Fulbright Schuman program, which runs across the European Union for research proposals that focus specifically on the US and EU transatlantic agenda. Aside from that, we also run the Education USA program, which for Americans is a little bit less relevant, but maybe interesting for you to know, in that we also promote the US higher education for Belgians looking to go study in the US for college or university. And we help provide information more generally about study opportunities in the US. So feel free to check out the educationusa.be website if that interests you as well. So the Fulbright program has a long history now, over 75 years. It was first established in 1946 by Senator J. William Fulbright, who signed it into law with President Harry Truman after World War II. The original purpose of this program was to increase mutual understanding between people in the US and people of other countries by sending American students and academics to those other countries and bringing foreign students and academics to the US to kind of have this cultural exchange. The first exchanges between US and Belgium and Luxembourg took place in 1948, so 2 years after the start of the Fulbright program. But the first exchanges with Fulbright Schuman only started between the EU in 1990. So today, the Fulbright program runs in over 160 countries around the world, as I'm sure many of you know, with over 400,000 alumni across the globe going to and from the US. So like I said, our commission focuses on Belgium, Luxembourg, and the Schuman program. Here's a general timeline of what it might look like if you do choose to apply for the grants. So first, you would be in this step now where you're applying for the grants through IIE. Back in the US, they do a first review, and if it makes it past that step, they send it over to us at the Fulbright Commission, where we then have interviews for everyone and select based off different criteria. If you're selected, you're informed by IIE, who will then let you know about that, and then I'll get in touch with you directly from the commission with more administrative issues, and then you come to Europe. So right now we're at the very beginning of this step, so you might have many different questions, but I hope to answer many of those for you today. And then if you have any more, feel free to send me an email after this. So the Fulbright Schuman program, what is it exactly? So like I said, we focus on quite a different range of programs at our commission, but I'll specifically just be talking about these two on the right. So the Fulbright Schuman program for EU citizens going to the US and for US citizens coming to the EU. It's only Americans on the call today, so really I'll be talking about this one here. So yeah, the Fulbright Schuman program is a little bit unique in that although it allows for a wide range of different topics, there still are a few criteria that allow you to apply for this program specifically and not instead a different Fulbright program. So first of all, this is a unique program between the US and the EU that provides funding specifically for transatlantic research on topics dealing with either US-EU relations, the EU institutions more generally, or EU policy. That is a huge range of topics, as I'm sure all of you know, and I'll try to give a few examples of what that looks like specifically. But the main question to ask yourself when applying for the Fulbright Schuman program instead of another bilateral program is, why does this research matter for the EU? And why does it matter for the US's relationship with the EU and not just a specific country within the EU? If it's just a specific country and relevance for that one country and its relationship with the US, then usually the bilateral programs that run across Europe are more suitable for you. This program is jointly financed by the U.S. State Department and the Directorate General for Education and Culture of the European Commission, and grants are available for American students, academics, and professionals to conduct research in one or more EU member states, and vice versa for European students and scholars to conduct research in the U.S. So if you're looking to go to multiple EU countries for your research, really the Fulbright Schuman Program is the best choice for you, because usually when you're doing a bilateral program, like if you're just coming to Belgium, then you can't really leave the country to do research in other EU countries. There is some flexibility on that that maybe I'll talk about later. But if you're looking to do research in multiple countries over an extended period of time, then really the Fulbright Schuman Program is right for you. So here's an overview for grants for US citizens that we have. In this webinar, I'm focusing more specifically on the US student program, but there is some information for scholars. And if anyone has questions about the scholar program, I'm also happy to answer those for you. In general, grants for US students coming to Europe are always for 9 months. We do allow for shorter duration, so don't let that 9 month period really be what stops you from applying. But in general, it's best for the academic year to come here for that extended period of time. Students coming to do research can either be from like a university, be a young professional with a few years experience, or come from a wide range of home institutions. It doesn't have to be that you were recently a graduate or are still currently enrolled. The only minimum requirement is that you have a bachelor's degree and not yet a PhD or a terminal degree if you're applying for the US student program. Keep in mind that candidates applying have to arrange for their own placements at either like an accredited university, vocational or professional institution, or other type of like research center or think tank. There are many different options in the EU for suitable host institutions. And you cannot really ask the Fulbright Commission either in Brussels or the local commission in the country you're looking to apply for help in order to find a host institution. That really is your responsibility. A letter of recommendation or invitation is not required at the time of application for you to have a host institution already in place, but you really, it is preferred, and you really should be contacting a suitable host before applying, just to make sure that they would be willing to host you, that they would be willing to help you get a residence permit if needed. But I'll talk a little bit more about that in just a moment. Keep in mind that grantees travel to Europe as part of the US Fulbright US student program. So if you travel to any of the EU countries that's suitable for you to travel between the countries as a part of the program, and that your home country is considered the EU more generally. So if you need research in multiple countries, that is totally fine. The benefits for this program are 2,000 euros per month for students and 3,000 euros per month for scholars. You also get an online pre-departure orientation, usually in April or May, before your grant would start in the fall. You get a travel allowance of 2,000 euros intended to defray travel and relocation costs, both for the flight to and from Europe, flights between European countries if you're going to multiple different countries, and also the visa costs. You get enrolled in ASPE, which is a sickness and accident benefits program to help you in case anything happens during your time in Europe. You also get participation in a one-week EU NATO seminar, which takes place between Brussels and Luxembourg City. Your flight and hotel and participation in that program is fully covered during that week, and that usually takes place between February or March. You also get a prestigious title and membership in an active alumni network, both in the US and Europe. There's many alumni spread across the world, so being in Fulbright really provides some great benefits even beyond the end of your grant. Here's a picture of what the EU NATO seminar looks like. So this was down at the European Court of Justice in Luxembourg City. So if you do get selected, you get to join a group like this of grantees across Europe, some European, some American, but all learning more about the EU and NATO. So to talk a little bit about the specificities of this program, I wanted to give some examples of what exactly you could do research on and what that looks like for this program compared to other Fulbright programs. So like I said earlier, There's not necessarily a requirement for a particular field of study for the Fulbright Schuman Program, but it does fund transatlantic research in political science, law, economics, but also linguistics, social sciences, public health, arts, as long as the project is relevant to Europe, the EU, and or US-EU relations. So as long as you can really justify that point and how it would be relevant to those two bodies, pretty much it would be good to go under the Fulbright Schuman Program. Oops, somehow, there we go. So like I said earlier, ask yourself, why is this relevant to the EU as a whole and not just one of its member states or not just to the US? It really should be relevant to the EU as they're providing funding for that as well. So for some recent examples of projects, someone has studied climate risk in judiciary studies. Someone studied music intervention as a tool to build social inclusion. Another one took a look at the different regional financial and fiscal crises in the monetary union in the EU to kind of see how the US could maybe learn a little bit about managing those crises back in the US as well. There are people looking at the rise of artificial intelligence and how the EU is looking to regulate that policy to build kind of examples that the US could follow and policy recommendations for people to follow in the US as well. People are looking at the new single market, the digital market. People are looking at data privacy is a big one, especially after GDPR was implemented a few years ago. So really, as long as you're looking at specific EU policies and how that might affect the US or how it could be implemented in the US, then those are some project ideas that you could also implement in your grants. So there are a few frequently asked questions that I wanted to cover here, but then there will be time for your own questions as well later if you have any of those for me. So the first one is usually specifically asked to me about what type of host institution you can work with and if you have to follow the Fulbright Commission advice in the host country that you're looking to go to. So let's say one example that I provide in my answer here is Denmark. So in Denmark, the residency is often linked to a higher education institution, and it's the higher education institution that has to start the process for you, has to basically do the vast majority of it. And unless you're going to a higher ed institution, it's very difficult to get a residence permit for the Fulbright Schuman program. So for us, we always say it's good to check in with local commissions or ask us for advice if you're unsure something would work, because the local commissions will know whether or not you can get a Fulbright or a host institution at that time. But once selected, we also help grantees figure out a plan towards residency that's suitable based on the project and the countries that they're looking to go to. So you can kind of keep your options open. It's best to contact host institutions, see if they've helped someone get a residence permit before. If it seems unlikely that you can do that, you can ask the local commission in that country or send an email to me and I'll help you figure that out as well. So in general, we're open to any type of host institution, but what really matters is that you're able to get a residence permit for the full duration of your residency in Europe, which links a little bit to my third question, which maybe I'll skip to here, just and I'll go back to the previous one in a second. So like I said, the Fulbright Schuman Program is fairly unique in the Fulbright program because it allows you to go to multiple countries during a single grant. There aren't many different programs that do that, but this is one of them, and we're super excited about that. So one question that we get is from grantees is often that their research might be very broad and would require research in multiple countries. So how many can you go to? In theory, the Fulbright Schuman Program allows you to go to as many countries as you want to go to, but in practice, there are actually serious restraints that might prevent you from going to as many as you would be interested in traveling to. The sweet spot we say is usually between 1 and 3 countries, maybe with brief research trips to other countries beyond that, but really, within 9 months, it's hard to get any concrete research done in more than, let's say, 3 countries. One major reason behind that is because you have to have a residency permit for the full duration of your grant. And you cannot really get a residency permit in the EU for under 90 days because Americans at the moment are currently exempt from getting a visa for under 90 days because they can just travel here without a visa for that period. So that means that you'll have to usually stay either in one country and get a visa for the full duration of that time, and then take brief research trips for under 90 days to other countries. Or you might stay in two countries with a visa for about 4 or 5 months in each of them and then travel to other ones. In very rare cases, you might be able to get a visa for three countries for 90 days each. That's extremely difficult and a lot of paperwork, and we really highly recommend that no one does that. If your research really requires it, it is possible and it has been done before, but we would probably try to convince you not to do that. And if you can plan your project to not require that, then that would really be ideal. At the same time, there are EU countries that are not in the Schengen area. The Schengen area is that single body of countries that have allowed each other to not require you essentially to go through customs or border control when going between those countries. So that means if your project is split between the Schengen area and countries in the EU that are not in Schengen, it is possible that you can have three countries with no visa because you will be spending less than 90 days in each of them. That's extremely rare, very difficult to plan, and that would be something that we would propose only if it turned out that you have that project already in mind. In the end, I would say it's best to plan for one or two countries and know that you can take research trips to other countries in the EU beyond that. That's the easiest for everyone, so something that I think you should keep in mind when applying. So, for example, if your grant was going to take you to Belgium, Denmark, and Spain, you could get a visa for each country, but it might be easier to just, for example, stay in Spain for 9 months and take flights to and from Belgium for maybe a month at a time, to do research trips that you plan quite carefully to those countries. One final FAQ that we get asked a lot is if the UK is still a part of this program. The UK used to be in the EU and was a partner country of the Fulbright Schuman Program since its original foundation in 1990. But since Brexit, this is no longer the case. So you cannot do your research there or affiliate with the UK institution if you, even if you do most of your research in Europe. In general, host institutions must be located in the EU, and our funding is only for projects and grants that take place within the EU's borders. It is possible if you have like related grant research in the UK, it would be allowed to go there for maybe a week or two during your grants to continue that research. But extended trips to the EU are not possible. Sorry, to the UK are not possible. And any travel to there that's not reported to the Commission could also result in reduced funding during your grants. I know that there are many UK institutions that have many European partners, and sometimes the policy there is very related or relevant to research done in the EU. But we've had some pretty strict, restrictions placed on us by the EU, saying that the UK is no longer in this program, and really we should not be providing any funding to people going to the UK for that purpose. So do keep that in mind. If you have a host that you really love there, maybe talk to them about a 1 week trip or doing virtual research with them while in the EU, as that's still very easy with the time zone difference as well. So first I wanted to provide some example projects very concretely so you can kind of see where people went, what they studied, for how long, and then I'll open it up to questions and start answering those. So first, a couple of years ago, we had a Fulbright Schuman student researcher named Susanna. She was American based in Belgium at the Egmont Institute, and she was doing research in international relations, specifically looking at the new European digital single market and how it was struggling a bit and maybe some things that the US could learn from it as well to also potentially implement back in the US. This was also looking at different perspectives of EU member states across the EU about this new digital single market, industry opinion on it, and public opinion about the policy implications and its new implementation at the time. here's an example project for a Fulbright Schuman scholar. This was Alex. He came to Germany and Belgium at the Hertie School of Governance in Germany and the Center for European Policy Studies in Belgium. He was looking at AI policy. This was even before ChatGPT became widely known, so he was really on the cutting edge of this. His study looked at kind of the two urgent challenges of democratic governance of AI, both how to like govern the use of it in the private sector, but then also how governments themselves should or should not use AI. So he was looking at the European Union's implementation of its safeguards already and how to use that experience in the EU to inform AI policy back in the US. He worked very closely also with the German government at the time. He was invited to the chancellery and has been really leading this since his time in Europe. So how to apply? Here are some QR codes that you can also scan to get to these web pages. The Fulbright student program has an application deadline of the 10th of October for this year. And again, if you have any questions about the application process, Kyler is here to help us answer those as well. If any scholars are on the call, the Fulbright Scholar Award is open until the 15th of September. So that's just a couple more weeks. You fill out an application online, and then this will be considered by the colleagues at IIE over the following weeks, and then sent to us usually in December or January for us to consider and interview you also in February or January of next year. If you're selected, you're told a couple months after that, and then you'll be here for the upcoming academic year starting in September 2024. Some helpful hints for applying. This is just general advice that our commission likes to give grantees as they're considering applying for their Fulbright program and as they think about whether or not they want to be a Fulbright grantee. So first of all, when applying, consider what does it mean to be a Fulbrighter? Like I said at the very beginning of this webinar, that the Fulbright program is really about promoting mutual understanding through cultural diplomacy. So it's about more than just research and academics. It's really about how can Belgium and Luxembourg or Belgium and, or sorry, how the US and Luxembourg or US and Belgium or the US and the EU more generally can really get to learn more about each other and just collaborate on these big issues together. So remember in your application to also focus on your ambassadorial qualities, but also the interest you have for educational exchange and living in a new country and getting to know more people and on collaborating on your projects beyond just also the actual research that you'll be doing. Remember also that you should be able to articulate a clear and creative plan, but also one that's feasible for your time in the EU. Remember that you'll have to be explaining your research not only in your applications, which will be very detailed, but also to many, many people who will not be in your field. The people at the interview will likely not be people in your field of study. So you should be able to talk about the plan both in minute detail, but also in an elevator pitch of about a minute that's very clear and that the layman can understand. When it comes to your host institution, remember that fit is a lot more important than prestige. So do take time to really consider host institutions that you have not heard about before, and that might actually be a very good fit for your project. And finally, we're also looking for candidates with strong motivation who want to realize their personal and professional goals and know what they want to do when they return to their home country with this new knowledge and experience. So it shouldn't just be, yeah, I want a gap year. I don't know what to do with my future. So I thought this would be fun. It really should be like, oh yeah, I see myself doing this. I want this to help me on my step to grad school or help me start a new chapter in my career, or like, why does this matter to you? And why should this research matter to people who aren't you, including Fulbrights or your colleagues that you will be collaborating with and beyond? So now with that advice, you can go ahead and contact me if you have further questions beyond this webinar. Again, this is recorded, so you can get this information later on. And I'll send this presentation to all the people here in attendance, so you'll have this already at hand. But I wanted to turn it over to some questions. So if you do have some questions, feel free to pop that in the Q&A section, and I will see that and answer that live. So I see the first question was already asked earlier. And what does research mean for Fulbright? Is there an expected end result? That is a really good question, and indeed a frequently asked question that I will probably can like use in future webinars. Research is really, really quite broad in the spectrum of Fulbrights. To be perfectly honest, our commission will not necessarily be asking you to provide concrete details of the types of publications you have after this project or specific end results. So really, that's kind of up to you. In general, research should be asking a specific question and have a clear plan for how you'll try to answer that question while in Europe. But for us, there's not a specific deliverable that you have to provide or a specific like goal. In general, you will be asked in the application, like, what do you want to do with this research and what your own plan is. So many people do plan on using this either for PhD research, for example, to start their PhD. Some people have already started their PhD and want to use this Fulbright experience as a year to kind of continue that further research that they have to dive deeper into their research question. Or maybe you want to have a publication, maybe you want to write a book. Really, it's up to you, but there should be kind of a clear plan for you to have for how you want to achieve that research and what exactly the question you're asking is and why that's relevant to the US or the EU more generally. Are there any other questions at the moment? I think that's the only one in the Q&A for now, but I'll give everyone a second in case there are more questions. If you feel like it'd be easier to ask a question, not written out, but actually like through voice, you can just raise your hand and I'll give you the ability to activate your microphone for that as well. All right, yeah, I see Meredith, that's a question. Meredith, you should be able to activate your microphone now.
Hi, yes, can you hear me all right?
Yeah, I can hear you great.
Thank you so much. Sorry, I was vigorously typing, so this is a little bit easier. I appreciate it. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit further about, in the statement of grant purpose, given how unique all of these different opportunities are and how it's sort of a mix of finding host institutions at the same time as proposing these research proposals. Are there any highlights or best practices that you've seen from applicants that you'd recommend as folks are getting started finalizing those?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I don't know if Kyler has an answer to that from her perspective at IIE, but what I will say is that in general, our commission really does not want to step on toes of other Fulbright programs. So for us, it's really important that the statement of purpose really highlights why this matters for the Fulbright Schuman program and not for a different one. I know that's not exactly the same as justifying your own research project, but I would say Fulbright, globally speaking, really supports research and academics like beyond, like more than you can imagine. Like if anything, I think we all wish we could provide the grant experience to more people. And really, usually, if you're applying for a Fulbright grant, you probably know what you're talking about and probably justifiably deserve a grant in most cases. The difficulty is that funding is limited, and we really are trying to fund the people who really know what they're doing and how a project can get done in those 9 months. So you should really be realistic. Some people really like to have very big expectations for what could be accomplished in 9 months. And really, a lot of the time, a Fulbright grant is kind of getting the ball rolling a little bit without having full concrete expectations. So, or like deliverables or a full publication, like that really takes longer than 9 months. So in your statement of grant purpose, keep in mind like why this matters for the Fulbright Schuman program and not just the bilateral program that might be a better suit for some projects. But also manage expectations, know kind of what's realistic. If you have like contacts already or research experience, that's really good to highlight as well. I'm not sure if that answers your question entirely, but Kyler, do you have anything that you'd like to add based on what she said there?
Hi, Jace. No, I think that was perfect. I think you summed it up great. I think a lot of students sometimes forget, you know, why is this important to the Schuman program specifically, you know, because you're proposing going to do different locations. And like you said, it's sometimes easy to just do your project in one of those locations, you know. So what is it exactly that draws you to the Schuman program? And I think if you have that nailed down and you make sure that everything is concise, then I think you're good to go.
Awesome. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you, Meredith. I see that there was another question in the chat from Kimberly. Will it be a good idea to have a letter of affiliation from an individual as well as from the institution too? I don't know if IIE puts any emphasis on one or the other. From our commission's perspective, it doesn't really matter if it's from an individual or an institution. I would say in general, institutions are the ones that are allowed to help you get a visa. So if anything, it should be from an institution. It's not really an added benefit from our commission's point of view if you have a specific letter from an individual as well. Tyler, is that also the case for IIE?
Yeah, I agree. I think overall, it's better to get affiliations from institutions because one, they can help secure visas. Two, they can provide more resources in terms of lab space, research. They can connect you with other people more easily. So I do recommend the institution route, but individuals are also fine. And if that's, you know, who you have, that's your connection, then that's totally fine. But we do say that institutions are a little bit better because you just get more access to resources.
Awesome. Thanks, Kyle. Yeah, and then a final question in the Q&A at the moment is from Carl. He says, can you apply for Fulbright if you're already based in Belgium as a design researcher? In general, the Fulbright program is really only open to people who do not have extensive experience in the EU doing research or otherwise. That's usually like extensive period within the last 5 years. If you're currently based in Belgium as a design researcher, I don't think you would be eligible for this program. Kyler, do you have any other specific information about that if IIE would allow for you?
Yeah, I would just say if you are already based in Belgium and you're trying to head back to Belgium, then there is like a 6-month residency requirement. So what I would recommend is you go to the award descriptions of the places that you're interested in attending. And if you go to the eligibility section, it'll clearly lay out how long you're allowed to be within that particular country. It'll also let you know if dual citizenship is eligible or not. So I would just triple check those like residency requirements so you know and understand if you can actually apply or not.
Yeah, exactly. One thing that we also keep in mind for people is that there during the interview process, our selections committee also really highlights people who already have extensive experience between the EU and US and people who don't have experience in the EU. And really, people who have extensive experience in the EU are at a competitive advantage with our commission, just because we're trying to provide new opportunities for people to kind of allow for that mutual exchange. And if you already have the contacts, if you're already working in Belgium, if you're already working on these projects, then really it's not the right fit for this program. We're trying to help people kind of develop those connections, develop a project that maybe they couldn't otherwise do. So I don't know if that applies in your case, Carl, but I just wanted to also add that to the answer. I see that Maya has raised her hand. So Maya, you should be now allowed to unmute yourself to ask your question online if you'd like.
Can you hear me? Yeah.
Yep, I can hear you great.
Do you have any tips on how to make the application flow like between countries when we're explaining why we want to be in like two countries in 1 year? Thanks.
Yeah, for sure. In general, when you're trying to go to multiple countries and justify that in your application, I think the first thing you have to do is really explain why those countries specifically, especially if you're looking at a specific like section of EU policy. Usually that applies to all 27 of the EU countries. So then the main question is, why do you want to go to those two? Then when you're justifying why you want to go between them, I think as long as you know how to justify kind of the amount of time you'd be spending in each of them and it sounds reasonable, I don't think that it's really that complicated to explain. Just say like, yeah, I want to start in Belgium because I know someone at the ULB and that will help me kind of get the ground running. They know a lot of people in the EU and I'll have connections from there and I'll stay there for 4 months to kind of get the ball running on the project. And then I'll go to Germany for 5 months to continue with other colleagues and maybe do research trips between the two. I think as long as you know how to more or less manage your time and explain that in a way that makes sense in the application, that most people kind of understand that this is a like initial proposal and not something that's super concrete. In fact, I would say a vast majority, if not almost everyone who applies for the Fulbright Schuman program has a conversation with me to be like, okay, is what I said in my application realistic for visas and for time management? If yes, then we implement it. If no, then we'll pivot and kind of make adjustments. So don't feel like you have to have like the perfect answer in your application for how you're splitting the time between the countries, but do have a solid justification for why you're going to those specific countries and who you're working with in those countries, if that makes sense. That answer the question more or less, Maya?
Yeah. Actually, I kind of follow up.
Go ahead.
I feel like Brussels is just so hard to like penetrate. Like they're so, like the institutions are, you know, so, you know, intense that it's kind of hard to like get connections. Do you have any tips on maybe how to do that?
Yeah, for sure. Brussels is for sure its own little puzzle. If you're trying to do research with institutions, my general advice is not to contact the institutions directly. You almost will never hear a direct answer from them, or if you do, it will take a very long time just because of the overwhelming amount of requests that they get every single year. Instead, what I recommend you do is do a quick search of think tanks in the Brussels area. If you just like search think tank Brussels and then your like a very short description of your project or even just kind of like your field of study for the project, then you'll find a huge number of think tanks, all of or almost all of which probably have heard of Fulbright or more or less know what we do for academic exchanges, and see if they'd be willing to host you there. And if so, the think tanks usually have a very good contacts at the EU institutions. They're usually writing policy papers or giving advice or meeting with commissioners, for example. So think tanks are usually the best way to break through. If your field is not really like, or if your project doesn't like link super well with the think tank, then my advice would be to contact one of the universities in Brussels via their own departments, because the universities will also have contacts both in the think tank population, but also at the European institutions. So if you're looking for research about institutions, don't contact them directly. I really think it's very hard to get in touch with them, but kind of go the indirect route through civil society, if that makes sense.
Thank you.
So yeah, thank you, Maya. One more question I see in the Q&A now is, what do we do if we can't find an affiliate? A lot of institutions don't want to take on the burden of helping people with visas, bringing people onto a project, etc. Yeah, that's a good question. And kind of multiple answers to that. The first one is that most of the time, the research that you do should not necessarily be a project that's already taking place. It really should be a new project that you're looking to do, mostly on your own, but of course, collaborating with other people while you do it. So you shouldn't really be looking for places that are willing to bring you onto a project, but rather kind of just support this project idea that you have yourself. My main advice to people when they're looking for host institutions is name drop Fulbright. I mean, I think it is better known through the like academic world in the EU than you might expect. There are many people who have not heard of it, of course, and so you might have to explain or send links. But if you just say, hey, I'm looking to apply for a grant that would allow me to do this project, and I'm really interested in working with you, I think you'd be surprised to hear how many people are actually willing to help you do that. Keep in mind, in most countries, the burden of applying for the residence permit is not necessarily placed on the institutions receiving you directly. In some countries, it is. Like I mentioned, in Denmark, it is the universities that have to apply for a visa. When that is the case, people are usually aware of that, and there are systems in place to help you do it. So that's not usually a huge barrier to helping you find an affiliate. So I would reach out, give information about Fulbright if they haven't heard of it already. But really, if you can't find one, keep trying. In the end, like I said, you don't need a letter of invitation at the time of your application. So if that's really what's stopping you from applying right now, you could still choose to do so and provide a letter later on. Because really, you'll just need one for when you're applying for a residence permit. I hope that answered that question. Are there any more questions either that people want to ask via chat or by raising their hands? Give everyone just one more minute. All right. Well, I am not seeing anything come in, so I think that that's everything. Thank you, everyone, for attending the webinar today and for asking these very mindful questions. I really appreciate that. I will send you an email after this with a link to the recording and the PowerPoint in case you just want to take a look at that while you're applying over the next couple of weeks. But thank you so much for taking part of this, and I really hope that we do receive an application from you, and I hope to have you all here in Europe very soon. Thank you as well to Kyler for joining me today to answer some questions from IIE's perspective, and for always being a great help for the Fulbright program. Thank you, everyone, and have a wonderful day.